Yeah, now is in live.
Hello everybody, welcome to the second webinar for CaratLane Designathon. And we have a very exciting presentation ready for all of you. We'll just wait for 5 minutes to let everybody join in and then we shall start. I hope everybody is doing well, everybody's been keeping safe, and we are so happy to have everybody join us this afternoon to know more about CaratLane Designathon and how we can all together solve these problem statements for our industry. We have a lot of friends joining in, so we'll just give them a few minutes so that everybody joins in and then we shall just start off. I think let's start. We still have an introduction. People can keep joining in. Good afternoon, everybody. We are glad to have you today with us for this afternoon. It's a second webinar for CaratLane Designathon, and we have prepared a very exciting presentation which will help you to solve these problem statements. The main theme of Designathon is to bringing functionality to design, especially jewelry design, and adding functionality in proportion to aesthetics. So giving as much importance to functionality as we all give to aesthetics. Today's theme is design evolution, where we will talk right from macro level of product design and how design has evolved over history, then come down to jewelry, and then come down to our specific problem statements that we have given for you all to solve. The design has evolved, you know, if only because there are people who spend time and years into thinking and innovating over it. But at the same time, there are products which have once designed and we still use them every day. So through case studies and detailed discussions today, we will take you through some unique inventions that have changed the way we wear and design jewelry and even some products. Today we have in the speaker panel, we have Mr. Frederick Mane, who's an artist and fine jewelry designer based in Paris. We have Ms. Shrimul Mehta Vyas, who's the principal designer and faculty at NID Ahmedabad. There is me, Preeta Agarwal. There's from the CaratLane team, we have Mr. Mithun Sacheti, who's the founder and MD of CaratLane. There is Akro Sharma, who's the senior VP at who handles merchandising fulfillment at CaratLane. There is Mimi, who is the business head at Shaya by CaratLane, which is their silver jewelry brand, and Kinnari Shah, who is head of jewelry design and development at CaratLane. And they all have something very exciting and very knowledgeable to add to our presentation today. Now, three inventions we will look at, which are so perfect that they've never required improvements. Imagine something which was invented in 1000 AD by Romans, like a pair of scissors. So this was the first pair of scissors. And if you carefully think, we still use these kind of scissors in fashion design to cut small threads. So these were designed in second century AD. That's a long, long time ago. And yes, it was such a beautiful design, such a practical design, and such a simple design that nobody wanted to reinvent it. There were people who tried the loop, the Chinese tried the loop mechanism, but again, we came back to this. And then in 1100 AD, the pivoted scissors came into play, where there were these two blades which function based on a central pivot. And what we know of scissors today, if you see, there are different shapes, different sizes, different curves, different, you know, the shapes that they cut into. but the main design remains the same. It is pivoted on a central point. There are two sides of handles and there are two sides of shears. So that's a simple design which was designed centuries ago and we still use it today. So it's such a brilliant design that nobody could reinvent it further. And that's what designers should look at. They should look at simplicity. They should look at minimalism. And those designs last lifetimes, I would say. Second example in designs which have never been improved are safety pin. It was designed in 1849 by Walter Hunt. And if you see, this is a sketch. And this figure one is what the simple spring mechanism on the one end and the lock mechanism on the other is what he had designed in 1849. And more than 250 years later, we still use these safety pins. And it's a brilliant design. Again, it's a simplistic, it's a classic, it's a minimalist design which people use. The only thing that has happened is facelift. So colors have been added, a lot of little things have been added onto it, but the basic function remains the same. In the same way, bicycle, when it was first invented in 1818, it was that there was no pedal. It was a simple thing which you would run on your foot. And we just had two wheels to support. And it got reinvented until and unless in 1890, the safety bicycle was invented. And since 1890, the bicycle remains the same. There are two wheels. It's a back wheel run where there's a chain and a pedal. The front wheel is just for support. It's not connected to the chain. And that safety bicycle is what we still use today. There are gears added onto it. There is all the fanciness. There are women's bicycles and men's bicycles. But the function remains the same. So since 1890, people have attempted to redesign the bicycle, but this design still remains the same. At the same time, there are also three products and ideas that we will showcase today, which are so versatile that they've changed beyond recognition. So when what they were invented out to be and what they are today are worlds apart. First example is the telephone. Like we all know, in 1876, Alexander Graham Bell invented the telephone, which looked something like this, where it's like a big instrument. It got reinvented, and by 2000, we had a little smaller phone, which had a little colored screen onto it, which went on to become a smartphone by 2007 and by 2010. So, and within the smartphones also, the journey is quite vast, right? From this foldable big instrument that we used to carry in 1996, to the iPhone 12 that we carry, and all kinds of connectivity and functions that we have. So a telephone from what it started in 1876 to the iPhone today is a huge journey. And there have been a lot of contributions on the way by various talented minds who have brought us today. And I'm sure this will keep evolving with every year, every new phone, every new function that they add on to it. Another very interesting example is the cinema. So how it started in 1893 with a small movie that they did to Netflix that it started in 1997. Who thought that we would be looking at cinemas in our house? It's called OTT, over the top. All these channels that you see like Voot, Hotstar, Netflix, Amazon Prime. Nobody even had thought 20 years ago that we will have everything available on our television screen. We don't need to go to cinema. For last 1 year, we haven't been to a cinema and we're not missing out on anything in terms of entertainment. We have actually a lot more choices of entertainment rather than just going to a cinema. So it's been a very, very interesting journey of cinema to Netflix that it is today. And third example that I have for you is a digital storage file. So if anybody remembers this 8-inch gigantic floppy disk, I do. In my childhood, my father had a box of it. And this was invented in 1967. So in the last 50 years or so, from 1967 to three sizes of floppy disk, a zip drive, a jazz drive, a CD disk, a DVD, a pen drive. I remember buying this in my college, 256 MB, and I had paid like 5,000 rupees for it. And today we have cloud storage in ZBs. There's a new term called ZB. More than TBs, there is ZB now. So data storage, it has evolved. You don't even need a machine. Everything is on the cloud these days. So this whole thing has improved a lot. The whole idea is why I'm sharing all these examples with you is because there is somebody who sat down and said, okay, this is not working. I need to think 10 years down the line and I need to invent something which will free us of this and create another product which people will use 10 years from now. So there are designers who have contributed, intelligent minds which have contributed to bring us to what lives we live today. And similarly, we are hoping that we do so for jewelry. And that is the main function of Designathon, where we encourage all of you to think beyond the aesthetics, beyond the top view of a piece of a jewelry, and think in terms of function, innovate and create products which will last a lifetime or which will create such an evolution that it will completely change the dynamics of the jewelry industry. And to give some examples from the jewelry sphere, we have Mr. Frederick Mane, who will give examples of jewelry designs so perfect that they've never required improvements. So Frederick, over to you.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm glad to take part with this second part of Karatline webinar about evolution based on technical evolution, innovation. As jewelry designer based in Paris for two decades, I consider some designs from famous brands as major references in terms of innovation in the jewelry field. And they became real identity for these brands, a kind of signature still used in their new collections. Sometimes brand designers can renew their colors or kind of stones, but the global design and techniques used are still the same. Now, let me introduce three iconic designs from these legendary brands. Let's admire the love bracelet from Cartier. Real screws fixed on the metal are the signature of the collection. And the funny thing, you need a little screwdriver to fix the piece on your wrist. And please don't lose the screwdriver, otherwise you will be like a prisoner in a golden cage. Let's continue with a nail from Cartier by Aldo Cipullo designer. The nail is a simple but strong idea. It is a little bit scary, but it's very precious because in gold. Also, the symbol to have a nail in your hand is a very spiritual symbol in the Christian religion. Very recently, from their archive, Cartier resurrected this forgotten model. Third example, the zip necklace from Van Cleef, by the famous designer René Puissant. It is a good example how a very common lock system can be converted into a piece of art. The model is still produced in their high-end jewelry collections. Now, let's start an interesting chapter. Jewelry ideas so versatile, they have changed beyond recognition. There, the interesting point is more than a symbol or a lock system. It is a material itself becoming a strong identity. For many jewelry customers, channel pearls are very iconic. But the young designer, Melania Gargopoulos, had the brilliant idea to divide pearls in quarter or half parts. It's clever because, as you know, a lot of pearls produced have defects or cracks and are useless at the end. This new way to divide pearls offers the possibility for the Japanese brand Tazaki to create a very modern and recognizable design and less classic than Chanel. Let's continue with locking mechanisms in the jewelry field. From back to front, you can see the iconic bracelet from Divan Jewelers. There, the prisoner handcuffs are the original inspiration. From the 70s, it is still a bestseller. At right, you see the famous and bestseller bracelet from Fred Jeweler. The lock system is inspired by both Shaker. Last but not least, I am honored to show you the last collection I designed for the brand Rubeus Milano. There, the interesting point is more than a design or lock system, is a technique of making jewelry itself becoming a strong identity. Let me tell you a short story. I was listening to Rihanna's song Shine Bright Like a Diamond, and I dreamt about a solid gold pieces having the same dazzling effect as a precious faceted stone. Very quickly, I created this new collection called Duomo. It means dome-shaped in Italian language. There, we didn't use the traditional casting process, but new cutting machine regularly used in the watch field. Each gold piece is directly cutted and faceted in these machines. The result is absolutely magic and ultra dazzling. Indeed, the Duomo collection, each gold facet are mechanically curved. At the end, all angles are cleaner than the traditional casting process. So now, Britta, you can show my little video.
So guys, if I can add a little bit to Frederick, this is innovation at another level, because till now we only knew that gold is being casted, or you make it from a sheet or you make it from a wire. But this mechanism is like a block of gold where you are faceting it like a gemstone. So the shine of each facet is much brighter. The edges, because you're not buffing the product at the end, the edges are much sharper. They are not like smooth and rounded like we do, because buffing leads to these rounded edges. So this one, I'll play that video again. If you see the shine of each facet, and the edge is so nice and crisp, as if it was like a diamond or a gemstone which was faceted. So now from casting, gold has led to lead, like the techniques which have led to faceting of gold. So this industry has also evolved. So all these examples that we showed, there are three that we showed, the Cartier Love bracelet, the nail bracelet, as well as the zip necklace. These are iconic. They were developed decades ago, and still every day somebody is buying a love bracelet or a nail bracelet, or somebody's waiting in a, like somebody's been waiting for months to get their zip necklace in their hands. And on the other hand, pearl industry, the gold casting industry, even the second one that we showed you, the locks, how the locks, the functionality of the locks has changed. So all these has changed so much in our industry only because of somebody like Frederick. For this ring, he sat down and he thought that, how can I create that effect? So you need to think, you need to research, maybe. I'm sure, Frederick, what was your research process behind getting into this? Like how did you come about saying fast, okay, we casted gold. Nobody's done it before.
I study a lot the watch process. I created a watch as well, and I was inspired by other technique from another field. It's always interesting for a designer to consider a lot of source inspiration from other fields than the jewelry field. You understand?
Yeah. So Frederick is saying that we need to get inspired from other fields as well. So look out. And that's why I was also showing you examples from the product industry, from safety pins to telephones to data storage. These are all different industries, and everybody is evolving. Everybody has been adding something, creating new. So why not in the jewelry industry also, that we all put our minds together and start creating something interesting? You can seek inspiration from any industry. Like in this case, Frederick got an inspiration from the watchmaking industry. You can go out and seek an inspiration from any industry, any product, anything that has been done, which you feel can be adapted or modified or converted into something that we can use in the jewelry industry. That's why observation and just, research is so important.
For example, Chanel used a space rocket ceramic for their white watches.
Yes.
Ceramic is from rockets. And as conclusion, my dear Britta, I would like to ask you, if you wear this ring, do you have the feeling to have a disco ball lighting on your hand?
Yes.
If the answer is yes, you will be ready to dance with me on the Rihanna song.
Yes, absolutely. We will do that. But yes, look at the shine. There is simple light. I'm not even sure if this video has been shot in a very proper light setup. It was shot in normal daylight in a room. And look at the how the facets are shining when the light hits it. It's such a beautiful ring. And a different mechanism to result into this. Because if you cast and make this piece and buff it, then all that shine and all that faceted edging will go very dull and it will just mellow down a little bit. Perfect. Frederick, anything else you would like to add? Should we move on?
It's okay. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you. Next over, we have a very interesting subject to add to our this whole presentation is intangible functions in jewelry. So till now, we've only been talking of the tangible functions, what we see, what we can hold. But there are some intangible functions involved. And that is where Ms. Shrimal Vyas will give us her great insights. Shrimal, over to you here.
Sure. Thank you so much, Preeta and Frederick. For taking us through very interesting, iconic products. Preeta, what you shared, which haven't really changed over centuries, and Frederick's stunning, you know, work. I've absolutely fallen in love with the work you do. I think the faceting is brilliant, and the way each facet is reflecting the light, you know, it's looking, the piece of ring is looking absolutely magical. Yeah, so having, you know, set the context that you both have done, I thought it would be interesting for me to extend the whole aspect of function, you know, and look at it in a more non-physical manner. And what I intend to say is that if jewelry has, you know, the primary function of, say, ornamentation and adornment, you know, and obviously we are talking about all the technical details and the principles on which the pieces of jewelry would be based. What I want to take, you know, our participants through is the whole aspect of non-physical, non-tangible functions of jewelry. And here, what I mean to say is that if jewelry at one level is for adornment, at the other level, jewelry can also act as, you know, something that you wear to seek a kind of protection. Jewelry is also something that enables or allows you to communicate without speaking words at all. So it could even be a means of very powerful non-verbal communication. Yeah, Preeta, can we go to the next slide, please? Yeah. So here, basically, when we talk of protection, protection could be physical in nature. And we have seen, you know, I don't have the example here right now, but there are physical forms of jewelry. When you look at ethnic jewelry of different cultures of the world, tribal jewelry from different parts of India, there are certain forms which are almost like, you know, they're going to protect the wearer. It could have sharp edges. It's something that you wear on your wrist and nobody can, you know, clasp a woman's wrist and so on. So the protection could be in terms of physical protection. But more importantly, I want to talk about protection, which is again, you know, at a more psychological level. And I would like to start with this whole concept of Stridhan, which is very, very commonly known and understood in India. And the whole aspect that as per the Hindu law, earlier women were not, you know, they could not, own or, you know, they could not get a part of the family's property. And therefore, when a woman got married, the family, the father would gift her with, you know, a lot of jewels and gold and all of that, and which would give her protection, which would safeguard her, you know, in needy times. Yeah, so this is one level of protection we are talking about. Yeah, Preeta, can we go to the next slide, please? Yeah, then when we talk of protection, all of us know about, you know, people wear jewelry, which are more like amulets, and you wear jewelry in a way that it's going to avoid, keep you away from negativity. So the first example I have on the left is an amulet. It's a coin-like pendant, which has verses from the Quran inscribed on it. And when the wearer wears it, you know, he or she gets a feeling of, you know, being protected, yeah, by the superpower, by the Almighty. Yeah, so this is one example. In the middle, what you see is a headband. This, I think, comes from Oman. And these little palms that you see here, they are called the hand of the Fatima, yeah, or Hamsa or Khamsa. And these are mainly popular in Arabic cultures. It's also used, you know, in the Jewish culture also. And this is a good luck charm. So the wearer of this, you know, headband is going to be protected from evil eye or will never get disease or, you know, will not ever be endangered. So it's about this protection that we are talking about. And the piece on the extreme right, this particular, it's an amulet again. It's a little case that you could open and you could have, you know, very affirmative, positive messages. Again, you know, you could have religious messages and things like that, that give you a notion of very, very strong psychological protection and security. Yeah, Preeta, we can move to the next one. Yeah. Now, the piece on the left side, which is a Gauri Shankaram from Tamil Nadu. Now, this is here, the pendant is a shrine of Lord Shiva. Yeah. So it's almost like you are wearing and carrying your God with you. And when you have your God, you're wearing your God and the carrying the shrine with you. Nobody can really harm you. Nobody can, you know, inflict anything negative on you. So this is again, you know, you wear pieces of jewelry which influence, you know, which give you positive influence. On the right side, again, it's a pendant which has miniature painting of, you know, Ganga. So these are pieces of jewelry which we still see very vibrantly in the Indian culture. And here, beyond adornment, beyond wearing so many grams of gold, I think the primary function is also to, you know, positively protect the wearer. Yeah, Preeta, we can move to the next one. Protection could also mean transferring of qualities. So on the right side, the necklace that we are seeing, these are the claws of tiger. And traditionally, it is believed that, you know, if you wear body parts of some of the animals, the qualities that the animal possesses gets transferred to the wearer. So a tiger is a symbol of, you know, power and courage and strength. And if you wear a neck piece which has the claws of a tiger, you know, the qualities, the virtues of that animal gets transferred to whoever is wearing that piece of jewelry. On the left, it's again a piece of tribal jewelry which has been made using teeth of whale. And again, the whole principle of, you know, transferring the qualities of the marine creature or the animal to the wearer and giving a kind of protection. Yeah, Preeta, we can move. Yeah. If jewelry is, you know, all about protection, it's also about non-verbal communication. And here on the left side, people who understand the Northeastern culture or know sufficiently about, you know, the Northeast and the cognacs of the Nagaland, basically this is a warring tribe and he's a Naga warrior of the cognac community. Now the heads that you see, he's worn as a piece of pendant. These are the enemies he's killed and the heads he has taken. Yeah. So just by looking at, you know, his pendant, you can tell that this person, you know, is a warrior belonging to a particular tribe of Nagaland. And this is what precisely I mean, that how do you have, you know, how do you understand the social identity of a person just through the things or the kind of jewelry he or she is wearing? And contrast to that image, I have the image on the right side. It could be of somebody who belongs to a social tribe, you know, it could be a, he could be a punk, he could be somebody who's a kind of a cult, belongs to a cult. Yeah, so again, when you look at this person wearing the kind of safety pin and the kind of piercing and other things, it's very, very easy to, you know, tell what kind of a social, you know, association that person might be having. Yeah, we move to the next one. Yeah, and my last slide is about also when we talk of communication. The piece on the left, or even if I'm to give you the example of the Mangal Sutra, a lady who's adorning a Mangal Sutra without her even saying, you know that she is a married person. Yeah, she's a married woman. So same way on the left side, the piece that you are seeing, it belongs to the Newar community of Nepal. And here in India, Southeast Asian countries, or at least, you know, the Indian subcontinent, we know that black beads are for, you know, keeping the evil eye away. So this is a very important piece of jewelry in the Newar community for the bride. Also, when the girl is, you know, just getting into her adolescence or the woman is getting into her old age, this piece of jewelry becomes important. So if you see a lady who's worn this, you know, you could easily tell which life stage the woman is at. Yeah. Similar example on the right side, the woman with nut. And Frederick, just to let you know, a nose ring in India is a sign of, you know, a woman whose husband is still alive. Yeah. So these are the kind of symbols and communication that can go through just the piece of jewelry that you're wearing. And if this is the symbol of the bride, on the right side, what you see is funerary jewelry. So in the European, in the Western culture, you know, when you're going, when somebody's died and you're going for somebody's funeral, you know, these are the kind of black beads, you know, you're going to wear. So what my take on the whole thing is that for the participants who are going to, you know, be working on exciting and entries for the design-a-thon, absolutely important, Preeta and Frederick, are the aesthetics and the functional aspect, the physical functionality of the product that you both have been, you know, very passionately talking about. And there is also an opportunity for the participants to layer it with another kind of functionality, which we have just shared with them. And I think today in India also, we need to understand that there is no dearth of brand who could create the most stunning pieces of jewelry. That's a given. I think today aesthetics is given. Performance of a piece of jewelry, it is expected by your consumers. Yeah, so today's consumers, and when I talk of the millennials and Gen Z, they are hungry for more. So what is that more that we are going to offer to them in terms of functionality? And this is where I thought, you know, the intangible, the non-physical functionality, which operates more at an emotional level, at a more psychological level, at a more social level, is also something, you know, the participants could consider. Obviously, layering, you know, the functionality that you both have spoken of, because I think if it's layered with this intangible aspect also, I think the perceived value of the piece of jewelry or what the piece of jewelry could mean to the wearer is going to be of a different order altogether. So here we are, Preeta, three of us talking in three very, very different directions. And I think the whole idea, our game plan is to, you know, open up our participants' minds and, you know, look at the whole thing of problem solving from very exciting, very different perspectives. So over to you, Preeta.
Thank you so much, Shimu. This was, even I didn't know a few of those. Thank you so much for this interesting talk. And yes, like Shimu said, why we are showing these examples to you from all different aspects is to encourage you to look at these problem statements from not just what we've written in text saying, okay, we need a hoop. Don't go so literal. Think of it as a larger problem. Think of it as a consumer. If you are a consumer of that product and you are facing that problem, how would you want it to be solved? How would you want it to be resolved in terms of technicality, in terms of function, in terms of wearability? What would you want as a perfect product? If you are also a consumer, then what would be the perfect product according to you? Think from a lot of perspectives. Some of them are here. I'm sure there are a lot of other angles that you can look at in when you come to solving these problem statements. And to help you now, as we are narrowing down onto our subject, next is actually we will come down again to the problem statements that we have shared in the competition. And we have Kinidi and Akrosh to help us literally tell that, okay, this is the problem statement and what has been done and what has not been done. So you will be able to work on it better. So Kinidi, it's an Akrosh, it's over to you from here.
Thank you, Shimul. That was really exciting, what you just shared. So our first task that we've shared with all of you is to solve the problem of women who have elongated earlobes or stretched piercings. And what's the expectation from the wearer? The wearer really wants a better fit, a snug fit. And Lisa, you would have, yeah. So there are certain solutions which are available. Like you can see the one in the on the left. This is what? Quite a new one, yes. Where the butterfly has been made elongated, which gives the wearer a better fit and comfort. At the same time, giving a better out, also better wearing on the ear, for the earring. The one on the right, the support disc, that's been always around. In India, we popularly call them as buttons, which have been traditionally around for the ladies to wear when the ear lobe starts drooping.
Sorry.
Yeah. And on the top where you see a hoop, this is also a solution to give a better fit for a hoop, where the post is little lowered down on the ear design, and then there is an omega back to give it a perfect fit. The only challenge with this solution is it's quite heavy for the everyday wear jewelry. So
these are some, really, Sorry to interrupt you. I'm just saying that we are trying to show here what is there in the market, what is the problem with those, and why we have put this still as a problem statement, so that you think beyond these and create something which is more practical to use. Right, Kinnari?
Yes, absolutely.
Perfect. The problem statement two, yeah.
So on the problem statement two, we are really, the gold prices are volatile. Currently, the gold prices skyrocketed. Every time that would happen, there would be need for lighter weight designs. And that's exactly our problem statement, that we want earrings under 1 gram using innovative techniques and mechanisms to make it give the wearer a higher perceived value. Certain things that we've already used in our jewelry are the silicone push that reduces weight by a few milligrams. Then we've used a hint of enamel to give it a larger look, an interesting design. We've also used electroformed as a technique, which again gives a quite a large look and a good 3D volume to it. And laser cut designs with gemstones.
So these are guys, some of the existing examples that these are used in Karat Lane currently?
Yes, these are all Karat Lane catalog that we've shared with you. And the objective is to use different techniques and mechanisms to come out with something that can be lightweight. Exploration of materials is also a little open, which should fall into the fine jewelry category. I think that could be a good
place. What kind of materials can you, like enamel is one material that you've shared here. Silicone for the backside is another material that we can see. Gemstone is here. So three we can see ready materials that you've already explored. What are the other materials like which you think are come under the fine jewelry sphere?
So we can use silver. We can use some other metal which can come in the fine jewelry sphere.
Okay.
Yeah, and if I may add.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, please. If I may add, you know, there are you have resin, ceramic, any kind of. See, ultimately, it's about getting surface area, right? As far as you can get the surface area, including the gold accent or you know the essence of gold in the design, so you don't let that go. You keep gold at the core of the design, and do the other materials or other forms or techniques to bring out space into the jewelry, bring in design and bring in things which are possible with jewelry. I think that's the opportunity here.
And mind you, I have one very interesting thing to add. Earrings are always a challenge because there are two of them, you know. So for a ring to be under a certain weight is still easier because it's a single product, or a pendant to be, it's a single product. Earrings, there has to be a post, there has to be a push, or any like a silicone push or a metal push. So all your weight is also going in these functional aspects of how to wear a piece of earring. And there are two pieces involved any which ways. So it becomes a bigger challenge to design earrings under a certain budget. Correct me if I'm wrong, Akrosh. Because there are two pieces that we need to work on here.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So in hooks, I feel because you are reducing the weight on from the push aspect, and that only the wire is like changed in a way so that it becomes a hook. That ways you're reducing a lot of metal here on the push part. But otherwise, because there are two pieces, it any which ways takes a lot of metal.
Yeah.
Perfect. Number three.
Out here, we are asking for the solution on the ring size. Our ask is to have a one size that fits all in the 1.5 gram and under gold weight. Finger rings are the highest selling category, actually. But because of the size ambiguity, it's not the most popular in gifting segment. And that's really the place that where we would really like solutions on. Preeta, can we move to the, yes. So these are few of the solutions that are existing.
So I've divided into two parts, Kinnari, for you, three here and these two are here.
Yes, so the ones on the left these were popular for the 22 carat, but frankly, for 14 carat, these won't really be feasible because 14 carat is far harder. And to get these stretchings done by a layman or person, it's not really possible. And also that it's not a very luxurious looking design. Eventually, this is luxury we are talking about. We won't want to give them something which is not so. And
like silver jewelry or fashion jewelry. Exactly. And these kinds of, especially this one is very popular in India, these kinds.
Exactly. In the 22 carat, it is highly popular.
22 carat, yes. Even in silver and fashion jewelry, you Absolutely. See people, all kinds of rings come with this adjustable backside. You just push them together and it kind of adjusts to the side.
Yeah, it's solving the solution for inventory. So definitely that's where it comes from.
Yes. The other two which are there. This.
Yes. These.
One second. Spoke,
yes. These are the ones, yeah, the flex rings that we spoke last time on, which flexes up to three sizes. And it's for a woman who has a wider knuckle and slimmer finger. So it gives a far snug fit. It's also for the purpose of, you know, using jewelry within the family if people can. If it's just about few sizes here and there.
So like sisters who want to share yes. jewelry, you know, simple as
yes,
that.
Absolutely. So
sisters share all kinds of, they share clothes and jewelry. And this, if some two people have slightly different finger sizes, then these rings work perfectly for them.
Perfectly. Yes, absolutely the case. And the one on the lower side is the bolo mechanism.
This one? With, this one.
Yeah. This is definitely a one size that fits all. It has
it
a very trendy.
As big as that to as small as that. And even yes. you can wear it on different fingers for your, like all the fingers are different sizes for a person's hand within like two
true,
hands.
True, absolutely.
Even your left hand fingers to your same right hand finger would be a different size. So, you know, if you want to today wear it on your left hand first finger or tomorrow on your second finger on your right hand, this one works perfectly. Otherwise, yeah. your finger, your rings become permanent for, okay, this is for this finger and this is for that finger. So this solves that problem as well. I
think. As well. Yes, absolutely.
Perfect. Going ahead.
Yeah. So like rings, even bangles, which are a sizer product, they have a restriction when it comes to inventory. You know, that really, and also bangles being a higher price point product. This is a place where holding inventory of multiple sizes pieces becomes a challenge for a retailer. So again, there are certain solutions which are available. The one on the left, the most famous one, the kind of mechanism that it uses is not possible on a large scale manufacturing. The kind of components and the time that it would take is quite humongous. And
also flexes to a few hands can wear it. It's not so rigid because there are some people who kind of open and close it a little bit according to the size at times. That's why I put this solution on my own.
Right. Yeah, but this one actually, when it comes to the oval, it does not really fit a lot of people because especially the women with really thinner wrist, they won't opt for something that is too loose.
It does. For thinner yes. wrist, this just falls very...
Exactly. It, no one would love that on wearing that.
Yeah, so. Like I'm wearing one here, but this fits like it sits very nicely on my wrist.
Exactly.
It doesn't
exactly.
fall... For thinner wrist, it just falls like that. So for right. me, it stays in place and that's why it doesn't move too much. That's why I like yeah. this. It's fit for me. But yes. it might not be fit for somebody else.
No, consumer would want, it's fine jewelry. People definitely want a good fit. Definitely. Yes. Always and ever.
Yes.
And yes, for our little ones. So we've got, we're looking for solutions on the secured back, but being ergonomically right. Because we are really looking for children. And it shouldn't be the case that it hurts them. Like in today's world, the kind of kids jewelry that is really available uses a lot of thick posts. It's not comfortable for the child, neither for the parent also. because then they have that little infection and so on and things, complications along with it. And hoops also is a little bit of a challenge. Putting a hoop on and taking it off or changing the earring, it's absolutely a daunting task for the parent as well as the child. So the idea is to really look for solutions which are user-friendly at the same time secure and comfortable for the children.
This, I think this industry, kids jewelry industry, really needs a lot of innovation, I feel. Because, especially for earring, because kids, earring is the only thing that they cannot remove themselves. Like bracelet, if you make a girl wear a bracelet, she might lose it, she might open it herself, or a pendant. But earrings, all parents want their little girls to wear earrings. And especially in India, earrings, like, you know, it's a tradition to get the ears pierced at a young age. Unlike Europe or US, where women don't have ears pierced, in India, you will find 99% of women who have at least one piercing. And it's a tradition, it's a part of our culture. And yet, when the ears are pierced, they have to put like a simple ball with a wire at the back and just stay like that for like good 7-8 years, because there is no easy mechanism or easy way to wear and remove and change it as per, you know, daily wear or as per their outfits. The mechanisms are very limited and still not very comfortable.
True.
Perfect. So these are some guidelines for the Carrot Lane problem statements. Kinnari, you want to go through them if there's anything you would like to add here?
So what we've tried to share is that we would like to use the theme as nature, so that eventually it all sinks in when we see it. And we would like to see at least 5 designs per solution. The solution scales need to be such that we can understand that they are usable in multiple stylings. That's the objective of asking minimum 5 designs. And price points, something we've already mentioned. Materials, yes, we've said gold, diamond, gemstones, pearls, enamel, quartz. And we've also discussed silver a while back. So we are open to using some other materials as well. And technique is absolutely open to innovation.
Why we've also kept nature as a common design theme is so that we want you to put less of effort on the aesthetic part of it. You can make a simple, very simple design and work more on the functioning part of it. So you don't need to worry so much about the beautification, or you need to make a very, very beautiful looking piece. As long as your function is strong, you can do a very simple theme, take something very simple, create a nice piece of earring or a ring or a bracelet, as long as your function is in place. Right, Kinnari?
Absolutely.
Perfect. Next, we have Mimi from Shaya, who will similarly explain her the silver jewelry problem statements that we have given. Mimi, over to you.
Yeah, hi. Thank you so much, Preeta. The first problem is one of the biggest reasons for returns that we have for earrings. A lot of the time, we make beautiful ear cuffs and they are loved and we sell them, but then their returns are just double of what other earrings are. And honestly, we have not been able to solve this problem. I have just given some images of some of the ear cuffs that we have. For example, the first two kinds, it's very difficult to make them fit for all, not just shapes, but all ear sizes. Like some of us have very small ears, and then there'll be people with more bigger ears, and then there's a size variation. The other thing is that even for the ones which are less size dependent, the ones where you use a clip-on to secure the ear cuffs, a lot of the times the reasons why customers are returning them is because A, it's not very comfortable, because sometimes they tend to hurt, And also it doesn't always secure it properly, especially when the motif is on a slightly heavier side. We have tried to add ravas at the end and various other, changing the location and things like that, but we haven't found a perfect solution. So the idea that we have really here is for someone to come and help us innovate and, with a functionality that will make ear cuffs fit all shapes and sizes. And not just fit, but also that it'll be comfortable to wear.
Perfect.
Preeta, do you have anything to add?
I feel that it is a global, it's not just a Shaya problem, it's a global problem. Everybody's been facing this. A lot of brands who wish to make good ear cuffs and a lot of girls who want to wear these for special occasions, like maybe one ear cuff you would want to wear or you would want to wear, wear it for a special occasion, for bridals, people do invest into them. And in the end, they're not very comfortable. Either they become very heavy because even weight is a problem, because if you have to cover the whole ear and then put a lot of mechanism at the back, the weight becomes too heavy. And again, that weight kind of keeps pulling you down. And these clips all across, these clips are not comfortable. Again, the clips might not fit somebody who has a thick side, the clip might not fit properly, or somebody who has a thin side. Often if somebody wears the clip breaks also. I have a piece where the clip broke at the top clip, and because
it deforms a lot
and eventually it breaks.
So
the solutions have not been there for ear cuffs, and women love to wear ear cuffs. It's a trend globally, but that trend has not been able to filter down from a runway to a daily life because of these practical issues. For a runway, for a 10-minute, 2-minute walk, women models are okay to wear a ear cuff and walk, and we secure it with all kinds of things at the back which you don't see from the front. But it's not become a style statement for an everyday girl. These are the issues that because of which ear cuffs are not becoming a part of our lives. And we're not able to wear them. So if anybody...
As much as we'd love to.
We would really love to, but unfortunately.
So the next one is the flipping of hoops. And I think the next slide would explain that better. So if you look at these pictures, the same hoops look differently on different ears, right? And ideally, the ideal one would be the one on the right. I also have the same problem. So I love hoops, but I'm not able to wear them because it just doesn't fit right. And we haven't done extensive research on this to understand the reasons. So whoever is working for this will have to also do a lot of, check a lot of ears and try out different things. I think it's due to the difference in the alignment of lobes, the shape and size of the lobes. But we would really love to have a solution where, a hoop can be tilted according to, the way the wearer wants it to be. So this is also a very, very important functionality, we think, for a lot of us who are not able to wear hoops as much as we would like to wear them.
Yeah, even I feel it's also to do with the whole ear. If you see this particular woman, and the ear is stuck to the side of the head a lot, versus this one where it is
a little
front, and that's why there is space at the back for the earring to kind of stay in place. Versus here, there is no space, and that's why the hoop becomes literally like 90 degrees perpendicular to the face. So it becomes flat like that, versus it should be like this. So it's also to do with the how the ears are aligned.
Yes.
So if your ears are really back and stuck to your head, then hoops are a problem. And hoops are a global thing, like especially in US, the sale of hoops is huge. People love to wear hoops in the US, but these problems are everyday issues, and this doesn't look nice. Like if you want to wear a single hoop and if it fits like this, it just looks something jutting out like that. You wouldn't feel pretty wearing this, versus if it falls like this, then it is ideal. Yeah,
absolutely.
So if there was some mechanism that you guys can think that can help us solve this.
That can make me wear hoops.
That can make me wear hoops. We would love that.
Yeah, in fact, I don't wear this kind of hoops. Otherwise, I would have been able to show you live. But yeah. So that is, I think this is one going to be one game changer if anyone is able to crack this.
Perfect.
Yeah. The last thing I would say is less of a functionality issue, but a smart design problem that we have. So Zoom keys, you know, are popular. Like even on our website, we see that even though we have very few Zoom keys, the menu section that calls out Zoom keys have like a phenomenal number of clicks, but we don't have them. And when we do, like we have to eventually discontinue them because they don't sell as much. And what we know is that people like looking at them, but they don't like buying them. The main reason for that is that it's a very 3D structure, right? And it has a tendency to be very heavy. And hence, you know, the price also tends to be higher than, you know, like the perceived value of it. I've shown you two examples that we've had to discontinue of hoops. I personally like them very much, but they just didn't fly off the shelves. So the idea is for you guys to come up with innovative, you know, techniques and ideas to make hoops that are really, really lightweight without losing the, Zoom keys, without losing the essence of the Zoom key, because I mean, if you sort of modify it too much, then it stops being a Zoom key, right? So I think this is something which would require a lot of technique exploration as well, because the idea is not just for it to be light, but also to look nice and sellable.
If I can add, for all the people who are joining us from outside India, a Zoom key is a little bell-shaped drop that you see here. So you have a small design on the top with a post at the back, and then there's a drop. There are usually one or two or three bell-shaped things. You can add as many. Usually there's a big bell-shaped drop with some hangings or some pearls around it, and it looks a beautiful design. It's a traditional Indian design, and although women love it, but these days it doesn't go with a dress or an evening wear. It usually goes with only traditional Indian outfits. So even that is a reason that you can't wear jumkis on a daily basis. It you just won't feel nice wearing them on a daily basis. You would require only a special occasion to wear a jumki. And that's why also I think, Mimi, your you know, people want everyday pieces. Occasions are becoming less and less.
Yeah.
And for a special occasion, people then maybe opt for a gold one or a, you know, a bigger one. And so they are not trendy. They are not. We want to make jumkis trendy. We want you to wear jumkis every day. And Indian women especially love jumkis. So we love to see them. But when it comes to clicking on add to cart, I think we just kind of hold ourselves back.
Yeah, and Preeta, I think a lot of the jumkis are, you know, like the ones which are very, very occasion specific, like you rightly said, people buy a lot of fine or like a lot of street jumkis.
Yeah.
The ones which are, you know, 200 bucks, 250 bucks, because they would be wearing them only once, right? Yeah. So I think that's also where the challenge is. So I think in that case, that also makes it really important for us to really differentiate the designs so that, you know, it doesn't get compared to the ones on the street.
Yes, perfect.
Yeah.
So guys, there are some, again, we have some design theme is same. There is silver, which is Shaya's main metal for use. And you can use as many materials. Mimi, for Shaya, you don't have any restrictions on?
We have no restriction at all. In fact, even in terms of the theme, Preeta, it's perfectly okay, because after you had that discussion with Canary earlier, if people don't want to invest so much time in thinking of a new theme And if they, I mean, because Shaya already has a lot of stories that we have, right? So if they want to add to any of those stories also, perfect. I think that should be fine. Yeah.
Yes, you can go onto the website and see what stories are going on under Shaya. And if you want to create probably a hoop or a jhumki under the same collection, pick up the basic aesthetics of that collection, like a leaf of the lotus collection or some of the collections. Yes. You can just pick those and then do a hoop or do a ear cuff around it, which where your solution can fit. So that also works for
absolutely.
So don't invest your time into things which we can any day change.
Yes.
Perfect. So these are some of the, not even restrictions, these are some of the open-ended rules that we have that you can play around with in terms of plating, materials, design language. We are open for everything. And that brings us to the end of this presentation today. And it's been a great session today. Thank you all. But before going, like last time, we have a lot of questions coming in. So let me read it out and I will maybe ask some of you to explain them. Number one is, I was wanting to know whether the 6 grams that have been specified for the bangle is for 24 gold or 14 karat gold. So if we go to that problem statement, Kennedy, can you?
Yes, it is 14 karat.
14 karat. So in like how we have said that it's below 6 grams of gold, that means it's below 6 grams of 14 karat gold or not 24 karat gold, right?
Yes, so yes.
Wherever we have mentioned any grams, is there any other?
Yes, it is there. In
1 gram of 14 karat. Here, I think we should be missed out on writing the karat here. This is also 6 grams of 14 karat gold.
14 karat gold, yes.
Perfect. There's one person asking, I was curious to know if participation in a team of 2 were accepted or not. Yes, like we also mentioned last time, we are open to team participation. When you can register under one name, and once you are uploading your submissions, you can attach a Word document or a statement saying that there are so many people. Don't go beyond 4 or 5 people, but under that number, you can create a team and work on a solution together. We are absolutely open for that. And everybody gets the credit for it. So that's absolutely good with us. Next, we have the brief states that we need to design a range with 10 designs of varying styles. I wanted to know if it needs to be a collection of 10 products with similar elements, or it needs to be completely different pieces which have no similarity. Kinneri, can you?
I think that's me, because I was the one who asked for 10.
Okay.
Okay,
this one.
Yeah. So, like I said, this is open. You can even pick like 10 different themes which are already there in under Shaya, and you can add like 1 to each of these. Or within the nature theme, you can have different, with the same mechanism, you can have 10 different styles of hoops, 1 smaller, 1 bigger, 1 shaped in a different way. Does that answer your question?
It does some parts. I would also like to add to it, why we are asking for multiple designs under each task is to see how that mechanism that you have created fits into a variety of pieces. We don't want
it to
be particularly fit to one particular design that you've created. And when we try and replicate that for all hoops, it doesn't work. So that's why we are asking you to design a range of 10 hoops or 5 bracelets or 5 rings, so that particular mechanism fits all. And that's why we are also saying that don't work on the aesthetics too much. Don't keep it simple, keep it classic. We don't want a very fancy design to look at. We want a very clever mechanism to work at. So that's why you can do 10 products which are simple in nature, have some differences. You can pick up from the website existing collections that are on the websites. You can use that collection and put your mechanism on it. And we want to see that mechanism works with a variety of hoops or a variety of bracelets. And that's why we're asking for multiple options. Next we have is, do we have to justify our design with supporting ethnographic primary and secondary research? If you can, it'll be very, very interesting and very helpful for us to understand where this concept is coming from and it will help us judge your design better. So if you have any ethnographic or any research that you've done, it will be very helpful for us to judge your design, to understand the mechanism and where you are coming from. So please submit as much. There is no restriction. It's not like a form that we are asking you to submit or just submit two sketches. You can put a folder together and share it. Share is on, I think, Google Drive. Yes, Hina, is it on Google Drive, right?
Yes.
Okay. So on Google Drive, you can share the link with us. Keep it open for everybody who has a link to read. So we don't need to have ask for access. Keep it open for access and put as much material in that folder as you can, but relevant material. Don't just put like tons of research onto it, but relevant material. Curate that final submission well, so that we as judges can understand it, because all of us who are on the panel today, all of us are going to go through these designs and we are going to see which mechanism or which idea works best. So we are all the judge in the jury as well. And so curate that submission, but give us your research also. Give us the background of how you've come to that solution. It will probably help us judge your entry better. Next question is, in reference to the design problem attached in the mail about dropping earlobes, are we just supposed to design earrings to hide the dropping earrings, or design something that will also stop further dropping of earlobes? Kennedy?
So it's not only about hiding. That can be done with a little larger design or something, but it's about getting the right fit. As you see the third image from left, yes, that's the kind of fit we desire.
The difference between this versus this. If
yes.
somebody has a larger ear hole, like a drooping earlobe, then it fits like this, or even larger ear hole. You know, people get the ear holes extend because of over wearing or heavy wearing earrings. And then again, the ear kind of droops like that. Whatever you wear, it falls down. It doesn't look straight up. The design kind of looks down. So that is the whole problem. And even if you make a larger earring, it still doesn't fit well. So it's not about the size of the earring, right, Kinnari? That even
yes,
if
I'm exactly earring, the point that it's not about hiding the earlobe. It's about getting the right fit for the earring for the wearer, which is that, yes.
Perfect. Okay. So work on the mechanism and not a bigger earring is the correct answer. I am a producer, designer, and manufacturer of jewelry. I wonder about several questions I am going to be listing below. Any piece design will be intellectual property of the designer. So, Mithun, I would need your help here.
Hi.
Somebody's asking about intellectual property of this mechanism that they design.
Akrosh, did you have a thought on that?
I think the IP of the mechanism in some ways will be shared with us by virtue of submitting it as part of the designathon contest. You're actually sharing the IP with us. We are obviously rewarding the designer with a royalty on a recurring sale. But I think that the real benefit that you should be looking at is the joy of solving this problem, and the fact that we at CaratLane believe in such problems to be solved, and we'll take it and give it scale. I think that's, and we'll make sure that if it's a powerful idea, you get your fair share of compensation for it as it hits the market.
Perfect. I hope that answers their question. In case you still have more doubts, you can always write to us and we can have a detailed discussion on that. Can we manufacture our piece design as well? Akrosh?
Yes, I mean, there are obviously other criteria that we need to make sure of, you know, facility, quality, you know, standards of, you know, people management standards at the factory, the other software aspects of identifying a manufacturing partner. But if you clear all of that, and the custody of diamonds and quality of materials, etc., then why not? That's actually a good thing.
is it a better solution that they, if you have, if you're a manufacturer and you can manufacture the piece yourself, please submit photographs or videos of the manufactured piece as well as the design in terms of sketch and technology, like the solution on paper as well. So maybe at CaratLane also we try and manufacture the same piece, right, Akrosh? And then we can figure out if both the ways, if their manufacturing and yours kind of match and the solution sure. is perfect. I think that's the winner there, right?
Yes.
Perfect. So if you can manufacture, it's better because you'll have a prototype to send us images and videos of. Maybe if it's very interesting, we can call for the piece and then look at it in person and take a call there. Next question is, could it be possible to us to manufacture our designs in case it wins?
Same question. So, we just addressed that, right? Yeah. So if it wins and if the factory has the ability to do it and it meets all of our criteria, then yes, we can have a manufacturing relationship as well. This is a design contest. This is a design effort. Yeah. So let's focus on the design part of it for the benefit of the rest of us.
Perfect. Can we go for materials like wood, resin, leather, etc., because it's precious metal, so we'll have to think about different factors like durability. We've just answered that. For Shaya, we are more flexible. For CaratLane problem statements, we have some restrictions because it's a 18 carat of 12 or 14 carat product, so we need to maintain the preciousness and the durability of that piece. When it comes to Shaya, we are more flexible in terms of materials and you can use wood, resin, leather, whatever you want in terms of creativity. Yes, please.
Yeah, sorry, Preeta. Yeah, while we are saying that we're flexible, the idea is that it should be practical to source, manufacture,
absolutely.
So that the design absolutely. Can actually go live. Yeah.
Yes, it should be a practical design. That is like a standard rule yeah. for everything. It should not be that, okay, in this one design only we can get, we can source one piece from somewhere and use it. It should yeah. be something which can be manufactured at a larger scale because Shaya creates pieces in a large quantity. So each design is multiplied into a huge number and then manufactured. So it should be multipliable and practical to manufacture at large scale. For CaratLane problem statement 2, there is a question where you have asked to create earrings under 1 gram 14 karat gold. There is no particular design that can't be submitted, right? I mean, excluding the specific designs displayed. I'm a little confused here. Kinnery, should I repeat this question for you?
Yes, please.
For this particular problem statement, somebody is asking that there is no particular design that can't be submitted. I mean, excluding the specific designs displayed.
Mm.
I think we are not looking at the front of any pieces.
Exactly.
We are looking at the.
So, yeah.
Yes, Akrosh.
Yeah, yeah. See, so, I think the question. See, the ultimate design solution, right? If you go back to even the examples that all three speakers spoke about in the beginning, is ideas which transcend time and hold together as a solution very, very well, right? Now, in this case, what we are talking about is you need to come up with methods which will bring down the gold weights, keeping the look large by different techniques, right? That's really at the core of it. It's not so much the design or the aesthetics. Of course, the aesthetics has to be pleasing, like Shimul said in the beginning, right? That it's table stakes now. A design which is not aesthetically pleasing to most people is not going to sell at all. So functionality is the key in this problem statement. How do we bring down the gold weight? How do we make it more affordable? And I'm just going to connect back to the alternate materials question, which was earlier before asked here.
Yeah.
It's fine to use alternate material in gold, but when you think of a design, just think about whether are you going to buy it, right? Am I going to pay 7,000-8,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees to buy a piece of what looks like a wood from front alone. So, you know, it has to look its price. It has to look meaningful. It's not just about adding gold just for the heck of adding gold itself, right? So it needs to have some meaningful role of gold in it.
Absolutely, that's very rightly placed, Akrosh, because people at CaratLane, who shop at CaratLane, I think they want that, you know, little. It's eventually gold. They're looking for sweet little pieces in 14 carat, 18 carat gold, which they can wear day in and day out. And that's the main reason why, you know, CaratLane has this whole large client database who are looking at sweet everyday wears in gold, right, Akrosh? Because it's like a precious jewel.
Yes, you wear yes. Every day.
Yet it's not heavy. It's not heavy on your pocket. It's not heavy on your ears. And it's the perfect fit. It's sweet. It's wearable. That's the whole idea when a person comes on the CaratLane website. That's what they're thinking, right? Let me buy something for myself or something for my family, which is sweet little thing to wear every day in gold.
Absolutely.
So that gold aspect is very important.
Yeah.
Okay, one second. Are these problem statements gender specific, especially earrings under 1 grams?
They are for women, at least we've designed for women.
Okay, so we
at least for a pair, at least for a pair.
Yes.
I think that's the key, right? Like if you make a men's stud at below 1 gram, of course you can make it, right? It's like one earring. Much simpler problem. Yeah.
Yes. So it's a pair of earrings, and that's how we, you know, we can look at it. You men can equally wear whatever they want as long as they're wearing it on both the ears. Tanvi has a question saying, "Does a jhumki has to be bell shaped?" Mimi, what is a jhumki now? Like, I think it yes. has to be bell shaped.
Yes.
That bell shape is what makes it a jhumki.
A jhumki. Yeah. Otherwise, it could be a chandelier or it could be anything.
It could be anything. So that bell yeah. shape, what the whole, you see that bell shape and you say, okay, it's a jhumki. So we'll yeah. have to work around that only. Another question related to jhumkis is, while working on jhumkis, do we also have to work on lockings and it has to be, or it has to be just styling and weight?
Okay. So, I mean, you have to work on the whole earring and that would include the locking, but you don't have to really think. I mean, you don't have to, we don't expect you to create a new innovation on the locking mechanism, if that's what you were asking. The idea behind this is really to make something that's really lightweight and wearable.
And trendy. I think,
yeah,
I
think in that is in slightly underlying. Yeah.
Yes. In this problem statement, it's the only one where we are not looking at creating and innovating in terms of a mechanism. But here, like it could be Shimul, is it like an intangible thing? We want to make jhumkis trendy and, you know, like that whole I know it's a little far-fetched to connect to intangible, but is it somewhere there that we want to make them trendy?
Absolutely, why not? You know, otherwise, as you said, it just remains limited to occasion wear. Why can't it be brought into our daily lives and with whatever clothes we wear, traditional, non-traditional, whatever it may be, I think it would be a good shot to see how can you make it a little cool and more, I mean, you know, trendy rather than very, very traditional. But I think, as you said, what's important is, where does a piece of jewelry stop being a jhumki and become something else? It's yeah. a very fine line that, you know, the participants will have to pay attention to. End of the day, we are looking for jhumkis as, you know, solutions. Yeah?
Perfect. Grams mentioned for all problem statements, do they include all materials or the total weight, including enamel and stones?
This is net weight, so it's not gross weight.
So it's the
additional materials are additional, extra over this, excluding.
So when I say 6 grams of 14 carat gold weight, that's only the gold weight. I can absolutely still have another few 1-2 grams of gemstones or any enamel or anything, right?
Yes.
Okay. So this is gold weight because that is the main deciding factor of the price. Am I right? That's why we're also...
Yes, that's where it comes from.
That's where this comes from. So it's not so much to be that it cannot be gross weight cannot be 8 grams or 10 grams. It can, as long as my price remains the same. That is controlled by those 6 grams of gold. Correct?
Correct.
Perfect.
I just want to add for Shaya, because at Shaya, we have kept the weight cap a little higher. And that should ideally be with everything, because the idea is also to not make them too heavy for the wearer. But then, of course, if you choose to make it like 50% wood, for example, it would be the total weight that we would consider.
Also, like when I say you can add a few grams, if it's a 6 gram bangle or a 10 gram jhumki, you cannot add another 10 grams of wood on it, right? It has to be practical. So it can be another few grams proportionately put. It cannot be 6 grams and the bangle is that big with a lot of enamel on it and just a little jali work at the back. You cannot disproportionate the whole look of it. Correct?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Preeta, may I also comment on this combination of materials? This question has come up a couple of times. Please. I think it's important because the hero of the product obviously is going to be gold. Yes, there is freedom to use any material, you know, that they would want to, but the material has to have a good enough reason to be there. Not just because I want to combine any two materials, I bring them together. And here again, the functionality and the property of the material. If, you know, for the ear cuffs, the clip is a problem, do I bring in a silicone, you know, it's just an example I'm giving so that, you know, the comfort on the ear is much, it's much better than, you know, contact with metal that gets pressed on to your ears. So
there's a purpose to it. There is a purpose.
Material must, because this whole, designathon is focusing on the functionality. So please bring in materials cleverly where they help us, you know, solve the problems better rather than just aesthetically, you know, making it look interesting.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Oh, there's another question saying, again, for weight, lightweight earrings problem statement, 1 to 1.5 grams, the total weight of the earring is for two pieces. Yes, it's for both the earrings together. It has to be 1.5 grams. In Shaya problem statement number one, do we have to work on the only the adjustability or can we also work on the hold of the ear cuffs? Mimi, are you there?
Yeah. So our problem is both the, you know, the inability of, or the difficulty in making a one size fits all solution, as well as the comfort in wearing it. So your solution should solve for both these problems.
So adjustability as well as the hold, both are equally important.
Yes.
Perfect.
And Preeta, just to make it a little, so if they're creating a full ear cuff, for example, right? I think the ability for it to fit all your sizes and shapes become very, very important. And if it is a clip like this, then it is probably on the ability to hold and in a comfortable as well as in a proper way. I think that becomes very, very important. And they could also choose to look at a design which features both, depending on what the design really is.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
Is it necessary that one must focus on functionality? What if one wants to focus on aesthetics? Will affect the judgment? Absolutely. This contest is all about bringing functionality to design and aesthetics. We're not looking at aesthetics as a major role player here. The major role player is the functionality. How do we track the number of pieces sold for royalty?
I'll take that. Yeah, we'll be tracking it and making it sharing it with the respective designs.
Okay, so you can trust us on that. We will give you all the details about it. How many pieces have sold? How many pieces? What are the prices? And accordingly, your royalty will be calculated. I don't think you should worry on that, considering it's Carrot Lane and. It's a wonderful team.
Yeah, we're a Tata Group company. We're bound by the Tata Code of Conduct.
Yes,
so if there's any doubt,
is huge.
Yeah,
So don't worry on those aspects. I think right now all you should think on is to solve these problem statements and royalty and rewards. If the solution is big, trust me, it will be a very big reward for you as well as for everyone. Can we combine two problem statements and make one collection? For example, keeping in mind the elongated earlobes problem, plus keeping in mind the price of gold. No, I think we would want them worked on separately, right, Kinnari? We can't have, because it will be difficult for us to that way.
Yeah, they are separate because the one which is on the lighter side is something which is for a younger audience, and the one with the drooping earlobe is for a older woman. So
yes, so let's not
they are definitely separate.
Yes, let's not mix the problem statements, guys. Let's keep them separate. We have carefully thought into each problem statement and given you respective parameters to work within, so please respect those. Design I sent for this, if I send the design for this competition, can I later manufacture or use it for myself or my company if not selected or even selected?
If it's selected, then no, it's with us. Obviously, if it's not selected, then it's open.
Okay, perfect. Can we use spring steel for the mechanism part which would be hidden?
Yeah, as far as we are able to measure the volume, the weight of the steel and be transparent with the consumer, so if the production process allows us to do that measurement at an individual piece level, yes, we can do it.
We can use them. Perfect.
So steel, titanium, any alternate material to provide strength, that's perfectly fine. Yeah.
What if a mechanism isn't selected by your team and isn't the winner in this competition? Then would Shaya or Caratlin use the mechanism, or they will be using only the ones that win?
If we use a mechanism, then we will definitely be sharing royalty for the mechanism.
So even if you're not selected in round one and you're not a winner, but if we eventually end up using that mechanism sometime, we will get in touch with you, right?
Yeah.
Perfect. Can I, there's one question. Can I take existing Shaya jewelry and modify it? Mimi?
I think... honestly, I haven't thought about that, but I don't think there is anything wrong with that. As long as you're improving it, I think that should not be a problem. Yeah.
Akrosh, any thoughts on this? Maybe for Caratlin as well as for Shaya?
I think as far as the spirit of innovation sits into the attempt, right? Like you're taking something and substantially improvising on it, then it makes a lot of sense. But if it's going to be an incremental, just adding a bell or a whistle here or there, I mean, it'll be a waste of your effort. So the right thing to do is to think of the problem grounds up. Along the way, while solving the problem, if you find that, okay, you know what, this existing design is already very beautiful and I can just put a better locking mechanism behind and that's really solved the problem, sure, go ahead and do that, because the intention of that problem is to look at the locking mechanism and not anything else, right? So it's fine to take the design and work on it, but the result should be dramatically better than the first.
So it's subjective, and it's you would also know in your heart like what you're doing. If you're just adding a little, like he said, bells and pearls somewhere, then that obviously doesn't qualify as a proper submission. But if you're changing it incrementally and it really improves the product, same product, but it completely changes the whole appeal and makes it absolutely sellable, we would love that. Perfect. I think that's it for all the questions today. And thank you so much, everybody who's been with us. And in case you still have any questions, you can do write to us on designathon@caratlane.com. We have been receiving a lot of queries and we've been replying to all of them. In case you still have any queries, please do write to us. And the last date for submission, that is the most important, because now there are no more webinars. We only had these two webinars to help you understand what we are looking for, answer all your questions. So these were the two webinars to help, where the whole team came together to explain everything to you. Now it's up to you how you put all of this knowledge and information together to solve these problems. And the submission deadline is 28th of April 2021, after which we will get into the jury mode and we will start analyzing all the submissions. So please do not forget the submission deadline. Try and upload a day or two in advance. Do not wait for the last minute. I know last minute panic creates a lot of good results, but please don't do that. Try and work in advance. Thank you so much. Take care, everybody. Thank you to all the panelists who've shared their time with us today and their knowledge, what they've brought on the table. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Best to the participants.
All the best to all the participants. Yes.
Yes. Yeah, all the best.
We're looking forward to some exciting solutions.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.